inviting Dr. Sarat Chandra for use of ethanol and short segment fixation for vertebral body haemangiomas. So, Dr. Sarat.
So, good afternoon, everybody. We started a technique which I will be shortly presenting more than 10 years ago, and it has become the sole option for our, not only for our entire department in the institute, but for the other other departments as well, which is managing with this kind of pathology. So we have heard the talks about vertebral haemangiomas and also the shortcomings of various aspects. Vertebrectomy, you know, you've heard a case, it's really difficult, you can lose your blood. Radiotherapy again has issues of radiation, vertebral necrosis. Cement does not kill the tumor cells, so you always can have recurrence. Now we started using obsolete alcohol more than a decade back. And if you go into the history, you find that it's one of the most powerful embolizing agents. In fact, it's been recommended by Nani et al. In 1983 for producing angioinfarction of kidneys for malignant hypertension. And for our own, I use the word most inexpensive. I don't want to use the word cheap because it makes you think that it's not very effective. It's most inexpensive, less than $1. But the only issue is what you find is that it does have a rapid systemic runoff, which can lead to certain cardiac or hypotensive problems. Now, in our institute, Professor N.K. Mishra had some experience of injecting percutaneously, and he did develop some issues with it. And I saw that most of these patients do have a transient deterioration of neurological status when injected percutaneously. And there have been some issues of pathological fractures also. And there have also been some issues where the patients have developed asystole. So if you see all the components which have been done, all the problems which have come up, the first is, of course, we know that when percutaneously alcohol is injected, even starting from Dockman et al., they have reported transient deterioration in almost 70% of the patients. Now obviously, and in one case of Brown circuit, obviously this is because you're injecting alcohol in a closed compartment and you're not relieving the compression. So the solution is to actually lead to spinal decompression. Then you are having the issue of systemic side effects, which could be easily overcome by giving small aliquots of administration of not more than half cc per each injection and being controlled under general anesthesia, where you can take care of this cardiac issues very easily. And the third component is to avoid pathological fractures, because absolute alcohol eats away the tumor. It's practically like a cure. It kills the tumor, leaving the weakened bony lattice, which could have a pathological fracture. And for that, you could take care of a single level instrumented fusion. So this was the fundamental basis by which this idea was born. And we have done more than 40 cases right now. So embolization without doing laminectomy, followed by single level fixation, followed by spinal cord decompression is what takes care of all the shortcomings which is there with percutaneous injection of absolute alcohol. And based on this, we published our first preliminary series in 2011. And more recently, we have come up with both pediatric series as well as adult, full cases of our adult series. And this is what I will show you over here. This is fundamentally to show you in brief how the surgical technique is done. Unfortunately, I cannot control the video over here. So once we place the pedicle screws both above and below the affected levels, there are certain nuances which have to be followed very, very rigidly, because you have to understand that whatever substance you are injecting is highly toxic. So the whole idea is that you should not, it's not that you should not use it, but you have to use it in a very, very careful and a controlled manner. So the first step is obviously to make a hole and then pass the Jemshiri needles, which is guided by neuronavigation, which goes into either pedicles. So there are two areas where you would like to inject the alcohol. One is in the middle of the vertebral body, where you should inject about 3 to 4 cc, and then you should withdraw it till the vertebro-pedicular junction, where you inject another 3 to 4 cc. So approximately you're injecting 6 to 7 cc on either side. So the average is coming somewhere between 12 to 14 cc. Even though in some cases we have gone up to 20 cc in multiple large, you know, much more complex kind of haemangiomas. So moment you remove the cannula, the trocar, you can see that the blood starts flowing very freely. Now it's very important to cover the operative area with wet saline gauzes. It's very, very important. And then you start the embolization. So about 3 to 4 cc at each level. So approximately 4 levels you embolize, middle of the vertebral body and thoracovertebral, pedicular vertebral junction. And you can see the embolization is almost instant. It becomes embolized almost instantly. And then when you withdraw, you can also embolize the vertebro-pedicular junction. So that is withdrawing and then doing further embolization at the vertebro-pedicular junction. So once again, you have some, so if you have once again some bleeding, once again another few cc can be injected. Unfortunately, I cannot control. So now you can go ahead and start doing the laminectomy. And you find that the laminectomy becomes absolutely bloodless. So even if you have a ventrally placed hemangioma, you don't have to go and remove it. They will shrink over a period of time. Very important, when you withdraw the gem sheet in Italy, you have to plug the opening with bone wax. Otherwise, there could be a retrogress flow of the absolute alcohol, which could be very toxic for the muscles and the skin. So it is very important to plug the opening with the bone wax. And now when you do a laminectomy, it's absolutely bloodless. So now this is from my earlier neurosurgical paper, and you can see that when you are removing it, the blood starts flowing very freely, and when you embolize, I really don't know how I'm going to finish in another 1 minute. But I just wanted to show you the impact of embolization, where you can see how it becomes totally bloodless. And then, okay, I'm going to skip this. So this is a video of a patient, and they usually start having lightening of limb from day one onwards. So I'll skip that. So we have had 33 patients, of which 5 were paraplegics, and the amount of average blood loss was around 200 cc. The mean amount of alcohol given was around 12 to 14 cc total. So about 3 to 4 cc on each side. So these are three cases. That's a pre-op, you can see severe compression, and that's a post-op, you can see how it's reduced. Another pre-op, 27-year-old, severe ventral compression. We don't deal with the ventral tissue. We inject into the body, and over a period of time, it regresses completely. Another patient, huge cutaneous hemangioma, who has underwent a laminectomy outside, came all paraplegic. This is the pre-op. This is the pre-op. And following post-op, there is a complete relief. Now, this 17-year-old female, again, coming with progressive weakness, severe compression. We do this, and you can see there is a complete regression, and there's also formation of bony sclerosis. This was at 20. I'll just take a few seconds if that's okay. 27-year-old female who was term pregnancy, and we had to do it in the lateral position, and she was paraplegic and she came back walking. And in fact, she was the wife of a reporter, and they put it on the papers because they were quite enamored by the fact that alcohol can actually cure something in the body, and she came walking. So there is a uniform improvement in all our patients, including paraplegics, including people who have sphincter involvement. Paraplegics, in fact, I had a video of a paraplegic for 6 months who started walking. So concluding, absolute alcohol is safe, it's effective, it's an easy method to cure hemangiomas. It's unlike bone cement, where you're passively filling it up without actually treating the tumor. You give alcohol, we have a decade of experience, it kills the tumor. There is no recurrence. Small aliquots, which adequate precautions, prevent any systemic toxicity or local toxicity. Plenty of irrigation, embolization before laminectomy, covering the area with gauze, and sealing the opening with bone wax are some of the key points. And the technique and the triad of embolization, open spinal decompression, single level fixation is a key for us, which has been the key for us to treat all categories of hemangiomas, even with long-standing paraplegias. And this has become the treatment of choice, not only for the entire department, but for the entire institute. And of course, last but not the least, it's highly inexpensive. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Chandra. do you do a, before embolizing and putting the alcohol, do you do a dye injection first? Because there are reports which say that if there is an epidural leak when you inject inside the body, then it's advisable not to put the alcohol there. So do you do a dye injection first?
Yes.
Into the
so the most important predictive factor is looking at the CT scan. So on the CT scan, if the cortical margin is intact, then you can be quite well reassured. But then considering, now you have to understand, you can't use alcohol for all kinds of vascular pathologies. The reason you can use it in hemangioma is because hemangioma is a very, very slow filling pathology. So when you inject half a cc, by the time it would transgress maybe about 1 or 2 centimeters, it's going to settle down. It's not going to move much more further. So even if there's a breach, if you're injecting a small amount of ethanol right in the center of the vertebral body, you need not be so afraid that it's going to breach and come out of that. Because of the nature of the pathology of hemangioma, which is a very slow filling kind of a pathology.
And what about when you fill it up at the vertebro-pedicle junction? Would you fear leakage at that time?
See, if the pedicle is disrupted as per the CT scan, then there could be some issues that there could be a breach into the spinal canal. But if it is intact, if you don't inject it at the pedicle itself because the margin is very small. But when you withdraw it, when you're in the vertebral body, slightly away from the pedicle or vertebral junction, that is where you give another 2 to 3 cc. And once you give that, you have instant embolization. And once that is over, when you're doing laminectomy, the whole laminectomy is bloodless. And you're doing it under plenty of irrigation and you're plugging. So if you take all these precautions, you are more or less taking care of all the. And we have come to learn this slowly over a period of time. For instance, we had a patient where I couldn't show you the complications, but that was one serious complication where there was a skin necrosis, and that the reason was that we couldn't plug. We somehow, I think one of the holes we forgot to plug with bone wax. So you have to rigidly follow all these things, and if you do, we strongly believe that it is one of the most effective mechanisms to treat. You've seen the last case, they were losing 6 liters of blood, 8 liters of blood. And in this, it's a very simple thing. You give it, it's going to shrivel over a period of time, you can forget it.
Great cases, Professor Sarat. Short question. In a case of recurrence, just like what Guru Raj showed in the morning, I mean, if you have a patient with a recurrence with a predominant soft tissue component and a butting on the cord, are you scared of using alcohol or you would go ahead and do the same procedure, same way?
Yes. Now, when there is a recurrence, you can still go ahead and give it. And there will be shrinkage which takes place almost the same day. Most of the patients, by the morning of surgery, when you ask, they will say, my myelopathy is coming down, I'm starting to feel light. So even if there's a massive soft tissue components, you give little of us, the whole thing starts shrinking. And it's such a simple technique, you can always go ahead and repeat it. You can give it in different stages.
You ever had any deterioration of neurology in these cases?
Yes, one patient we had a neurological deterioration. We did a CT scan, the screws were in place, and we felt that in this case most of the soft tissue component was placed ventrally. So we did do adequate spinal decompression, we gave him the steroids and improved completely. In fact, he did very well. When he came on follow-up, he did very well. Now if you see the original reports of transpercutaneous injection of alcohol by Dockman et al. 80% of their patients transiently deteriorate initially and then they improve much better. But by doing the initial spinal decompression, you're bypassing that initial transient deterioration.
The classically reported on the MRI in the hemangioma, which is non-compressive. Do you really tell your patient these are the warning signs, or how do you manage them?
Yes. So if you see, hemangiomas is the most common pathology. Even Harvey Cushing had hemangioma. And it happens in 10% of the population. You don't have to treat them.
But do you tell them that these are the warning signs you should consider when you see them?
If they develop symptoms of myelopathy or regular MRI checkups every 6 months or every 1 year, and if you think it's going to behave in an aggressive manner, so maybe you can do a follow-up MRI and then you can intervene.
Shashank, one last question. Go ahead. Quick question and quick response.
It's not a question, it's more of a comment, because Earlier, many years ago when we started doing this, our intervention radiologists used to do it. Professor N.K. Mishra used to percutaneously inject alcohol. Do nothing else, just inject alcohol. And at that time, I remember we had two patients who had got the collapse, the vertebral collapse, and they developed myelopathy. And we had a big trouble trying, and one of them did not improve. So a walking patient in whom a percutaneous procedure was done without stabilization, the vertebra collapsed, and the patient had a bad outcome. That's what set this thing, that we open and stabilize first and then do the alcohol injection rather than percutaneously inject.
So how does it compare with bone cement plus fixation?
Yes.
And
you have to understand that bone cement is not a curative material. It's passively filling up the spaces and the tumor will continue growing. Absolute alcohol is a tumoricidal agent. It leads to destruction of the tumor and leads to formation of new bone after a period of 6 months to 1 year. All the follow-ups we have had, even Professor Kale has done it, comes after 1.5 to 2 years, there is a new bone formation. So there is a huge fundamental difference between just injecting cement. I feel you can inject cement if you want to plug the hole. But otherwise, it doesn't do anything much more than to just passively fill up the spaces and provide some stability. Whereas if you're injecting alcohol, it's destroying the tumor. And then you're stabilizing, you're having a win-win situation.
Thank you very much. I think we have to stop. We're 20 minutes late already.